got to get their hearts in the right place. God, this morning as we've all come together to pray, I pray that your spirit would be on these individuals this morning. I pray this morning, dear God, Lord, that your power would be overflowing in this room, dear Jesus, dear God, Lord. God, Lord, that you would lift up teachers. God.
I have journeyed through the long dark night, out on the open sea. By faith alone, sight unknown, yet that's when his eyes were watching me. The anchor hold, though the ship is battered, the anchor as I face the raging seas, the anchor holds in spite of the storm. I've had visions and I've had dreams, and I've even held them in my hand. But I never knew they could slip right through, like they were only grains of is battered, the anchor holds, though the sails are torn.
there cannot be a more perfect statement than that right now. The anchor does hold. And, you know, I think in this time and in this place when so much is going on around us that we have to listen to and have to get frustrated with, and it is frustrating. It is frustrating. But you know what? Jesus is there. He's there through every bit of this, and he is, and it is, and it will hold. And you know what? And we're going to come out of this on the other side, folks. You know, I think sometimes we forget that piece of the puzzle. I'm sitting here getting ready to preach, and I'm trying to get my mind there today, Sammy, and Sister Wanda sings, you know, the song right there that's one of my favorite that me and my brothers used to sing together, and then David follows it up with that, and I'm like, you know what? I'm just almost get lost a little bit sometimes. Just thankful to be in God's house. Just thankful to be in God's house. You know, y'all, we're still getting experience this, and I know, and there's a part of me that wants to apologize, but there is. There are a lot of people, there are a lot of Christians today that aren't in church this morning. And for a lot of reasons. And you know what I'm saying? Whether they can be there, whether they can't be there, whether the leaders of their church don't want to have church. And, you know, and I have to be honest. I'm thankful I'm here. I am. I'm Lawrence, I'm thankful. I do. I agree with you, David. I do. I just, this week's been a tough week. There's a lot going on, and sometimes things that y'all don't know about, not that everybody knows, and sometimes it gets weighed on us, and we're trying to make the best decisions possible with all the information that's put in front of us. And but, you know, I'm thankful, Mike, that I can still get up on a Sunday morning, you know, and come down to God's house and worship. And I'm going to be honest with y'all. This is Joey. I cannot speak for anybody else in the room. I come into this house without fear. I do. I made a joke to somebody the other day. I said, my wife teaches. My daughter teaches. Matthew's going to be at school up at Georgia Tech. Me and Max are in construction. I'm more scared to go home. But I can honestly say I can walk into this room without fear. I do. I walk into this room without fear, and I thank God for that. I don't think twice about it. I understand the decisions that people have to make, and I'm okay with all of that. But, you know, I thank God that, you know, I talked with one of my own brothers this week, and they don't even know. They don't even know when they're going back to church. And, but man, I'm going to tell y'all, praise God in heaven, we can still come into his house, surely. We can still come into his house and worship his name. Even if it's eight people in the choir, Wanda. Told Debbie you're going to have to sing loud today. But that's okay. That's okay. You know what? While we're in God's house, let's take it, let's peel it back, let's lift it off, and let's praise him and let's worship him. So you got your Bibles this morning. Let's turn over to the book of Matthew. We're going to turn over to the book of Matthew. We're going to be in chapter 25. We've been there for a couple weeks. Kind of leading up to this week, Jesus talked about a great decision you had to make when we talked about the virgins a couple weeks ago and making the right choices, making the one right choice. And I'm going to be honest with y'all. If you don't hear anything else today, if you don't pay attention to the word that Joey says, the one right choice. It's not in your Democratic or your, it's not in your Democratic Party or the Republican Party. You know, it's not in the Libertarian Party. It's not, that's not the right choice. It's not the right choice to be afraid or to be fearful. The right choice isn't to listen. The only right choice that we can make is in our Savior, Jesus Christ. Okay? That's the choice that matters. And that's the choice that Jesus taught those, that was taught through the virgins. And last week we talked about the talents. We talked about the talents and you know what, to be aware that our Savior is returning. And today we're going to talk about what is going to happen on that day. We're going to talk about looking at the evidence in the courtroom. You know, there's going to be some evidence, Toby. You know what I'm saying? There's some evidence that's out there, Deke. There is. And there's going to be some evidence in the Bible explains that to us. So if you got your Bibles, let's turn over to the book of Matthew, chapter 25. I'm going to be in verse 31. I think I'm going to read to 33. I think I'm going to read to 33 this morning, so y'all bear with me for just a minute. And the Bible says, and when the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit on the throne of his glory. And before him shall all be together, all nations, and he shall separate them one from another as a shepherd divideth its sheep from the goats. And he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on his left. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, this morning to God, Lord. God, just thankful for the time we have to come into your house. And God, for the Christians that are out that are listening, God, that are part of this church, they'll hear this message later. And God, Lord, that may have some health issues. Lord, that they may have some things going on in their lives and they can't be here. And God, I just pray to God that you're with them today, Lord. I pray that you're touching hands upon them. There's so many of our family members, dear God, Lord, that they're affected by things that are going on around us. But God, I believe with all of my heart. I believe with the deepest part of my heart. I believe with all that is in me that you have control over this. God, I just pray this morning, God, Lord, as we're hearing here today, and God, we examine your word and we're able to open up your word this morning, God, you'd give us a better understanding of what you'd have us to see in your scriptures today, God. Lord, let us leave this room, dear God, Lord, not just looking to you, but glorifying your name, dear God, Lord, as we walk out into a lost and dying world, dear Jesus, dear God, Lord. Lord, that we can give them and show them the hope of a light of the one of your Son. I just pray that you'd be with us this morning, dear God, Lord. Lead us, guide us, direct us as only you can. And it's in your holy name we pray. Amen. You know, Wanda sang it, and the choir sang it in a little different version this morning. There's coming a day. There is coming a day. I think there's a day that there's part of us that as we get prepared for that day and we get prepared for that time and we get prepared for that event, we want to ignore it and we want to think about, but there's coming a day when we're going to meet Jesus, okay? Whether you like it or whether you don't, whether you believe in it or not, there's coming a day when we're going to meet the Almighty, Shirley. That day's coming. Now, I know that for some of us, that day's going to be exciting. It is. For some of us, buddy, we're going to get there that day. And I love that song that talks about what will I do when I see him. You know, I have no ideas what I'm going to do. You know, am I going to dance? Am I going to cry? Am I going to drop them? I have no ideas what's going to happen that day. But there is a day that's coming that we're going to all meet Jesus. Everybody in this room, okay? Everybody in this room. But Jesus talks about an event that is coming, that's out in front of us. Not only are we going to meet him, but there's going to come a day of judgment. There's going to come a day. And I know that nobody wants to hear about the day of judgment. I know that nobody, that doesn't excite people in the realms today. That doesn't, Wanda. It's not something that we're excited about. But there's going to be a day that we, every human being that ever lived, every human being that ever walked, every human being that ever breathed, is going to stand before the Almighty. Yeah, there we are, Dick. You know, that's something we can't, you know, we can't lay out that day. I'd like to call in sick that day. I think there's some people in churches, of Baptist churches, and Methodist churches, they probably are, Randy. They're going to probably want to call in sick. Like, man, that would be the day if I'm going to let, man, I don't want to show up for that day. And I'll be honest with you, for a lot of reasons, a lot of people will feel that way. Now, Jesus is very clear to help us understand some things that are going to happen on that day, Dick. He is. The Bible, he tells us. You know, he doesn't, like, hide it from us. Like, you know, I wonder what's going to happen at that event. I wonder, Jason, what I'm going to go through. What's Jesus going to throw out? But Jesus is very clear to tell us something's going to happen that day. Jesus tells us that, you know what? You're going to be on one side or the other. You know, that's what's funny is we talk in a world that we live in a political world that we constantly talk about the right, the left, being over here somewhere in the middle. Everybody like, you know, for a politician, the place, Jerry, that politicians like to operate is in the middle somewhere. You know that? Politicians, they like to be in the middle because if they're in the middle, they can make the guy a little bit over here on the right happy and they can make the guy a little bit over to the left happy. But Christ is very quick to say there is no middle. That middle fence that we like to operate on, you know, the place where we like to make, we think we can make everybody happy, Sammy. You know, the fence is a great place because it's kind of like, man, I can jump on this side of the pasture if I need to, or, you know, if I want to, I can jump back over here on this side of the pasture, and I can play both sides. And there are a lot of Christians in their walk that they will try to play both sides. They'll have the side that Brother Dennis are going to dress up on Sunday. They're going to dress up on Sunday, and they're going to come in here, and, man, from all aspects of people looking at them, they'd say, man, I tell you what, there is an upstanding Christian that sits there on that church pew. People are going to look at them from their aspect. You know, Don, and they're going to take off those clothes on Sunday, and then they're going to go into their workplace, and they're going to go live their life, and they may sometimes not talk the way they should, Toby. You ever been around a guy that was a preacher or a deacon or whatever it was, and you knew they went to church, and you listened to them talk, and you're like, man, that joker goes to church. That joker's a deacon somewhere. That joker's a minister somewhere. Hey, that, and you know what? Even deeper than that, buddy, that joker's a Christian. Well, I'm going to tell you something. You know what that is? It's called playing both sides. I'm going to play the religious side. I'm going to go do my thing on Sunday morning. I'm going to come in here to the church on Sunday, and I'm going to look right. I'm going to act right. I'm going to do what seems to be right. And then I'm going to go out during the week and I'm going to live whatever way I want to. Jesus makes an announcement. There aren't but two sides to this. He says several times throughout the New Testament that you're either for me or you're against me. He makes it very plain that there is going to be a great separation. Now, I'm going to tell you something. There are not a lot of messages in my life that I will preach and talk about hell, not because I'm not afraid of it, not because I don't think it's real. I think hell is probably one of the scariest dominions that exist. I'll be honest with you. I really will. I think hell is probably the scariest dominion that exists. And I've often told my sons that if God could crack open hell for just a second and let us glimpse, I don't even know if it would take a second for us to hear the screams and the cries of what's there. You know, I'm going to tell you what, and the torment that may exist, Sammy, the torment that may exist for those that made their choices and they made their beds, but everything that may exist, I think if you could just hear a half of a second of what's going on, it would probably petrify you for the rest of your life, for the rest of your life. It would change, it would be an image that you could not erase. But I'm going to tell you, the screams and the horrors of that place are not from the pain and the agony that are going on there. Lee, I think the greatest scream that is going on there is from the ultimate separation. And I mean that. The ultimate separation from God. Let me tell you what's the coolest thing, Brother Randy, that's really cool, that excites me. Is I can go down beside my bed, or I can be in my truck, or Lawrence, I can walk out to a tree, or I can get up with a cup of coffee and sit on the front porch. You know what I can do? I can talk to the Father. I'll be honest with you, Sammy, I believe with all my heart that He's listening to me. But there's coming a day when there's going to be a separation, that there are going to be some people that are going to cry out to the Almighty, surely. They are going to look to the Almighty for some relief, for some compassion. A separation where they cannot be heard. Their screams and their cries will just go on and on throughout eternity because they cannot be heard. All have to do with the choices that they have made. Jesus says that as He comes to this great throne and He's sitting there, He said, I'm going to look at everything that's going on. I'm going to tell you something. That's what's funny about the church today and what we do. I call it the great courtroom. Because as He sits there that day, and as He looks, Sammy, as He looks and He digests everything that's going on, and as He's examining, God's going to be looking at one thing. He's going to be looking at something that's called evidence. Y'all didn't know that, did you? God's going to be looking for some evidence. He is. The Bible tells us that. When He sits in that great courtroom one day, and as He sits there before everybody, as He has separated everything that is in front of Him, He is then going to start gleaning evidence. listen to me, God is going to glean through the evidence. Now, I'm going to tell y'all something about a mass murderer or a person that goes to trial. I'm going to tell y'all something. It's kind of a cool element. Dennis, you served in court. You served in some courtrooms, hadn't you, along the way? When you go to a courtroom a lot of times, there's an individual that's on trial. And there's one specific thing about that individual that's different from anybody else in that courtroom. You know what it is? He's the only one that knows the truth. I mean, there are people in that room that are trying to judge what they think to be the truth is. There are people that are looking around of all the things that go on. But I'm going to tell you something, Deke. That guy that is sitting there before the judge, that individual that sits there as he is being judged, he is honestly the only one in that room that really knows the truth. There's been people that have gone before judges and that they've gone before judges for murder. You know, they've gone before judges for spousal abuse. They've gone before judges for stealing. You know, and all the things that will come down that may prove something and all the stories that may be told in the courtroom, I'm going to tell you something. The only person that really knows the truth is that individual. Well, I'm going to tell y'all something. On this day, that changes. Because, see, there are two people that know the truth. There are two people that are going to be there that know the truth. There's going to be me, and there's going to be God the Almighty. You know, and Randy, I could tell all the lies and I could tell all the stories and I can make up all the things that I want to about how I want the truth to be seen, Deke. Man, I tell you, let me show you what I did. But I'm going to tell you something. God is going to look at the evidence and He's going to know the truth. That's what's funny about this courtroom. The Bible tells us that as He separates these individuals, as He separates them from one side to the other, God starts gleaning for the evidence. What was the evidence that He was looking for? There's something that He's actually looking for. You say, Joe, when you read the scripture in the Bible, a lot of times people would think, you know, I knew this. I knew a long time ago Joey's talking about salvation. It's all about works, but it's not. It's not about works. But works become the evidence. Well, that's kind of funny, isn't it? We're not saved by our works, but works become the evidence. As Jesus sits there, the Bible says that He talks to the sheep, and He looks at them. He looks at those individuals, and the Bible says, "For I was hungry, and you gave me meat." You hear that? It says, "I was thirsty, and you gave me drink." He did. That's what He said, Dennis. It says, "I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came unto me." Jesus looks harsh at the evidence, and they sit there. The Bible tells us that as the sheep, and as they sit there, and they look to the God, the Almighty, and God said, "What is this evidence of? What is it that you see? What is it that you see? What is it that God sees?" Now, he's looking for something, and He sees these things, but it's evidence of something, surely. It's evidence of something that's there. Now, all of my life, I've gone to church. I'm a very lucky individual. I say that because I had a mother and a father that, from the day I was a young lad, if you want to call it that they have taken me to church. They were committed to that. There are people in this room that they didn't go to church as kids, and you know what? They found Christ somewhere along the way, and they've made it their way to try to get into this room, and they've done everything they can. But I'm gonna tell you, I was very lucky. Donna, Priscilla, they brought me to church. They did everything they can to teach me what the Bible says, Deke, as parents, and I'm thankful for that. They did everything they can to show me how to live right according to what the Bible says. They showed me how to do right according to what the Bible says. And so a lot would believe that as you're raised in this, that your ethics would change. Okay? You say, man, there's a lot of this that you can really, Sammy, without any indication. You can try to kind of do the right things. And there are a lot of people that sit in my same shoes. They've went to church their entire lives. They've been there every Sunday. They put on their coats and ties. They put on their pretty dresses. They put on their makeups, and they were taught to do those things. And they thought that there was an understanding. Hey, I'm going to go down that path. But what is God looking for? Is he looking for us going down a path of our ethics or what he's taught? But you see, there was something that happened to Joey along the way. Something that special happened that Don and Priscilla could not teach me, okay? Don and Priscilla could do a lot of things for me, Jake. They could. They could do a lot of things for me. They could give to me. They could guide me. But there was one thing about my life that they could not change. And I'm going to tell you what, folks. I believe this with all of my heart. You can't make somebody love somebody else. I'm being honest with you, genuinely. You can't. You can't make, I don't care how much you teach it, Lawrence. I don't care how good a parent you are. You can't teach your kids to love other people. You can try to show them how to do the right things. You can show them down the right path. But you can't show them how to love other people. You can't, Shirley. I'm going to tell you something. That only comes from one place. You know, Jesus was questioned a long time ago. They were asking what the greatest of the commandments were. And when Jesus was being questioned about this, he said, you know the commandments. You know what they are. You know, honor God. But then he offered a new commandment, and what did he say? He said, love thy neighbor as thyself. Do you know what the greatest indication that Jesus lives here at all? Do you know what the greatest indication, evidence that he's here, is love for other people? I'll be honest with you. There's some people that are in this church today, and I've got to experience it. I have. There are some people that are in this church today that work an event. Y'all heard all that you want to hear about it, but it's called Hope for the Hungry. It is. It's an awesome thing if you come and see, if you have ever experienced it, if you've ever taken time to take love. But I'm gonna tell you what happens a little bit at Hope for the Hungry and what I've seen. There are a lot of people that are coming here. There are a lot of people that are coming here that we don't know. You know that I talked to some of the guys Sunday night, and we were talking about what was transpiring in church, and Brother Lawrence, I don't mean to call you out, Lawrence. Lawrence said, Joey, I just talked to 161 people I didn't even know today. I don't know what any of them had. You know what? But Lawrence and that whole group of people, they were out there. They're serving people that they don't even know. You know what I'm saying? Now, I recognize that there are people that come to this event that are going to cheat the system. I get it. I'm not stupid. There are some people out there, Jim, we know that. There's some people that probably don't need it, but they see that it's free and they're going to take advantage of it. But then there are some people that I've noticed when I have been here, there are some people that maybe they've lost their jobs and maybe they've gone through something in their life and they don't understand and they couldn't predict it. It just happened to them. Jerry, it was something they were going through at that moment in time. You know what? And they're scared. They don't know where to go. They come to this church out in the middle of nowhere, just trying to find something to help them. And praise God in heaven above, there's some people who have the love of Jesus, and there's nothing else to say other than that about it, that have the love of Jesus glowing inside of them, that are there to help them. And then there's a group of people that don't know any better, that maybe they can't think for themselves or make good decisions or whatever. And I tell Lynn all the time, it is our God-given right to help those people. That is what we, you know what, if you knocked out the other two and said, I don't want to miss, our church is all over the place. Church is all up, man, Joe, I don't want to have an event like that. We're going to drag all kinds of people in our world. Be careful. You be careful. When I got here 5 years ago, there was a message on our answering machine that said, if you need help, to call these different places in Carrollton, to call these different events. And I'm going to tell you something, folks, and y'all can throw rocks at me. There is nothing that made me matter. What in the world is wrong with the church being the light at the end of the tunnel? I'm going to tell you what, those folks are looking to us when there is nowhere else to go. So Jesus says there's evidence. And the evidence that shows is evidence of love. Love for one another. I'm love that we don't have, You know what? When you have a kind-hearted love, Sammy, that doesn't make sense. That, you know what, Beverly, how many times that, and I don't want to mean this in a bad way, but Beverly, how many times have you been back there counseling somebody and you know that they hadn't taken a bath and you know that they weren't clean and they didn't come in there and they weren't the person that you necessarily wanted to talk to, but you know what? You know that they needed God. That you know that they needed somebody to go to. And you know what you did? You went and wrapped your arms around them. You went and wrapped your arms around them and you prayed with them. That's the love I'm talking about. A love that says, I don't care what your situation is. A love that says, I don't care what you deserve. You know, there's people, a lot of times Christians will say, that guy's in that situation because he deserves it. I'm going to tell you something, folks. You listen to me and you listen very close to what I'm about to say. There is none of us that deserves what we have today. Not one of us. I don't deserve what Jesus did for me on that cross. I don't deserve that, but I thank God for that every day. Think about what I'm saying. I thank God that He sent His Son. I don't deserve it. I tell you what, it breaks my heart when I hear people say they deserve that. Brother Don, I'm going to tell you something. Praise God in heaven of God and heaven above. I don't get what I deserve. I'm going to tell you something. If you want to thank God when you go home, if you can't thank God for anything else tonight, you get on your knees tonight and you say, God, thank you for not giving me what I deserve. Because none of us deserve this. None of us deserve this. But Jesus said He looks and He sees and He examines and He sees the situation and He sees these people that are crying out. And He says, I see the evidence. I see the evidence of love. I see a person that thought more of what I called them to do than they did themselves. Now, there's going to be a lot of proclaimers. Surely they are. There's going to be a lot of proclaimers, Curtis. There's going to be a lot of people. The Bible even says there's going to be people that show up to Jesus one day. You know what are they going to say, Sammy? Did we not do this in your name? Hey, did we not preach in your name? Did we not prophesy in your name? Did we not do miracles in your name? Jesus is going to say, I never knew who you were. Listen to what He said. I never knew who you were. Which meant there was nothing in here. I'm going to tell you something, folks. That's the thing that's always feared me my whole life. That scared me worse than anything. Is I go to church with a lot of people along the way. I go to church with a lot of people who are going through motions. Who are stepping across steps. But there is nothing that exists in here. There's never been. Man, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to make sure I'm at church on Sunday. I'm going to tell you something, folks. If you're trying to make sure you're doing something, I can promise you right now, you're missing out on the biggest thing in the world. You are absolutely missing out. Because this whole thing changes when the love of God exists in you. You know what? There's a long time ago, as I was trying in my own life, and I was trying to work and do, and all of a sudden, it's like the whole light shined on me, and you know, Beverly did. It's when God opened me up, and it's just, it is. It's like, as you would say, a spiritual awakening to help you see in the love of God. I'm like, man, this isn't about me. That's why I listen to preachers today that preach, and they complain about preaching at churches, and they complain about being there, and I think to myself, man, y'all fellas are missing it. There are people that'll tell me sometimes, surely they'll say, you know, Brother Joe, I know what you're doing's hard. You know, surely I know, and I know y'all experience it. Like, man, I know what you're going through is hard. You know, Sammy, I know what you're going through is hard. I'm going to tell you something, folks. I'm the luckiest person on the face of this earth. God called me to do something, and I am thankful for what God called me to do and what He's doing. I'm loving every minute. I get to see people's lives changed. I get to see people come to Jesus Christ. I get to see people grow in God. I'm going to tell you something. You couldn't have it any better than this. People say they don't want to be part of it. You know why? You know why you don't? It's because you listen to old slewfoot Satan. You are. There's a lot of people today that listen to old slewfoot, and they're like, "Man, you don't need to be there. You don't need to have. You don't need to help. You don't need. I don't care what that old preacher's saying. Just quit. Don't pay attention to him. Just keep doing what you're doing. Hey, listen. You just sit on that pew, and you go on Sunday morning. You're going to be just fine. You're going to be just fine." But you know what Jesus said? You are not just fine. Because there's something internally wrong. John would go on to write that Jesus says that if you love me, you will keep my commandments. Y'all know that verse in the Bible, don't you? Y'all heard that, y'all? You know that? You know, and if you love me, Jesus said, love me like your neighbor, the evidence of it. You're helping people. You're doing the right thing. But he goes on to say something else. He also goes on in some verses right after that says that if you don't do these things, the truth is not in you. Is that what it says, Sammy? The truth is not in you, and you're a liar. And you say, you'd have to say to yourself, who am I lying? Am I lying to God? Am I lying to my children? Am I lying to the church? I'm going to tell you something, folks. The greatest lie you can tell, the greatest lie that you can tell today is when you lie to yourself. When you lie to yourself and you've convinced yourself that, hey, I'm on a good path. But you see, when that day comes, Shirley, when that day comes, Jason, and we have a moment when we're sitting in front of the Almighty and we're sitting in front of the God and the evidence is put before us. You know, the thing about it is, Deke, is we knew. And not only did we knew the whole time. Now, how many messages have you seen? It's easy to me sometimes, y'all. I say this. I've been in church a good part of my life. Don't mind saying this and not afraid of it. Lynn and them grew up in a different, I don't mean to bring this in, we grew up in a different thought process, and when we say something all the time about people being black backslid and people losing their way, and maybe they're not, but I grew up in church, and I've been in here a long time. And I've seen a lot of people, Debbie, that get excited for Jesus and work for Jesus. And I, on the other hand, and go out and do wonderful things. And as a human being, I see people that have no love in them, that call themselves Christians. Now, I'm going to be honest with y'all. I'm a human being. I'm not judging anybody. I have no reason to judge God. I have no reason to judge a soul. But you know what? Even as ignorant as I am, and I don't mind calling myself that when it comes to this, even as ignorant and as unintelligent as I am compared to the Almighty Judge, I can see it. I'm just being honest. I can see it. And I'm going to tell you something. If this young old country boy from Dallas, Georgia, that lives in Dallas down here, that's just an old preacher down here at this little bitty church, can see the difference in somebody like Sister Shirley that has God all over. Okay? Y'all listen to what I'm saying now. If I can see that, do you not think the Almighty can see it? You think he's that blind? I think some of y'all are betting that he's that blind. You're hoping that he's that blind. Well, I got some bad news for you. He's not blind. He's not blind at all. He can see for all it's worth, and he's paying attention to every one of you. And I'm going to tell you something, folks. We today, Joe, what do I need to do? Do I need to start giving to people more? We don't need to get whatever right. Do I need to go to the prisons? I'm going to tell you what you need to do. You need to get your heart right. That's what you got to do. I'll be honest with you, Shirley. I mean, I don't mind. I'm preaching to her. Maybe I tag you in right here. Is it going to get... She said she's going to let me do that one day, Jimmy. I'm telling you, more than anything else, what that individual needs to do, Joey, do they need to start dressing right? Do they need to start living right? Do they need to change the way they talk? No, they don't. They don't need to do any of those things. They need to get down to this altar. They get down to this altar that's been here for a long time. They need to get down on their knees. They say, God, I've been trying to figure this out for a long time. And God, I need you to forgive me. And I need to quit playing what I'm doing. I'm asking you today to come into my heart. I'm going to tell you something, folks. What the Baptist church needs, what the Methodist church needs, what Catholicism needs. I'm going to tell you what it needs today, what Christianity needs today. We don't need some identifiers. We need an identity change in our hearts. And I'm going to tell you something, folks. If we would do that, I'm going to tell you something. We could blow this world wide open for Jesus Christ. You know why we're satisfied we're sitting on pews today? Because too many of us have never made a heart change right here. Sammy, it's just the truth. It is the truth. And we don't want to hear the truth, but it is the truth. But you know what's going to happen, Toby? What's going to become a day? God's going to get up there, and he's going to sit down. He's going to set us all down, and Toby, come on up here. Let's go. It's going to be you today. Sammy said he's tired of me picking on him. Sit down. God's going to be looking at old Toby. You know, it's like, Dad, you know, Joey, my dad was a deacon. Toby, I don't care what your dad was. I don't care what your dad was. And, you know, but God, I had a company to run. God's like, you know, Toby, I'm fully aware of your company. I know everything that was going on. You know, but man, I tell you, I tried. How many people you think is going to sit up there and say, I tried? God, I tried. I'm going to tell you something, folks, that don't work. Trying to be a Christian doesn't work. It only works when we turn this over to him. You know what I'm saying? So God's going to say, you know, Toby, I tried. And God's going to maybe take a little sit down. He said, Toby, let me grab your hand for a second. Don't go COVID on me, okay? I look back down and I'm looking on that. And I knew that a long time ago you lived in sin. And I knew that you couldn't get out of that sin. And I was willing to send my son for you. And I don't know, how old were you when you got saved? You know, God said, I remember when you were 19, Toby. When you were 19, you asked my son to come into your life. Now, did you mean that?
Yes.
Did you mean that with all of your heart?
I did.
You see, that's the thing that God's going to know the truth. Don't matter how many times, just like he sat there with Peter that night. Lord, you know that I love you. Lord, you know that I love you. Lord, you know that I love you. Then go do what I ask you to do. Go do what I've commanded you to do. You see, I think that a lot of us are going to sit there with Toby, just like Toby is, and we're going to sit there on that day, and we're going to sit there, and we're going to try with all of our might. We're going to try with all of our heart. But I'm going to tell you something, folks. The only thing that's going to matter is what's right there in your heart. It's what's right there in your heart. That's where I want to close at today. I want you to think about what's right here in your heart. Because no amount of deeds, no amount of works, I'm not driven to preach today because of you know what, that was some cool job I thought I wanted to have one day, Joey. I'm here because God changed my heart. When I see Marchie and I see Beverly and I see Don, I see these people, I see Don leading a group of them, he's not doing that because he ain't got nothing to do on Wednesday night. He's not leading a prayer group because there wasn't something else going on. He's there because God changed his heart. You understand what I'm saying? When you see that young person teaching Sunday school class, and I compliment my kids, and I've watched them change over the last couple of years, and God's, and I'm going to tell y'all what, I don't care what anybody says. My kids are not the greatest kids in the world, but I'm proud of them. They're not, but I'm proud of them. I'm not proud because of where they go to school or where they graduate. I'm proud of the fact of what they do for God. I watch Matthew get tied up in something at Georgia Tech and his group. I watch Max get tied up in something. That's what brings me pride, that there's something greater. There's something greater than money. There's something greater than a job. There's something greater that exists. It's God. You know what? And we just soon go serve the master. But you know what? They're not doing it because their dad was a preacher and their mom thought it was cool. They're doing it because something changed their heart. Man, how do I get there, Joey? How do I go down that path, Joey? I want to be like this, Joey. You got to let Jesus change your heart. Because, see, that's what he's going to be looking for that day. He's only going to be looking for one thing. The other parts of it are just evidence that it even existed at all. But he's looking for a heart change that had some blood on it. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we're so grateful for the things that you've done for us. God, I don't know the hearts of the people that are here today. God, I'll be honest with you. I believe with all my heart sometimes I even mess up preaching. But dear God, I know this for a fact. I know the Holy Spirit can't mess it up. And I believe with all of my heart the Holy Spirit is here today. I do. And I believe, dear God, Lord, that there's somebody in this room today that the Holy Spirit's tugging on today. Because they know. Maybe nobody else in the room knows, but they know that they don't know the Master today. God, Lord, this morning I just pray, Lord, that there's one here today that's never accepted you as their Savior. They can't find a time in their life that they can go back to. God, I'm a big believer that you ought to know the date. You ought to have some idea when it was. But you know what? You ought to be able to go back to that moment in time when you turned your life over to Jesus. It is the most biggest decision you ever made. I kind of got to believe you got to know when that is. But Lord, they can't find a time in their life. Lord, they've been going to church for a long time. They've been doing a lot of deeds for a long time. But Lord, they've never made a commitment to Jesus Christ as their Savior. I pray this morning to God, this morning they'd come and get on their knees. Lord, they'd ask Jesus to come in. They'd ask Jesus to become a part of their life. And God, maybe there's one here today that maybe they've been part of this, they've come to this church, that's visited, and they say, you know what, I want to be part of this church. I want to join this church. I want to open up the doors of the church this morning to God, Lord, that if they want to come down this morning, say, I want to be part of this. I pray this morning, Lord, that you'd move in that life. I want to be part of the ministry that God is doing with Concord in this area today, dear God, Lord, in this community. I just pray, God, that you would be with lives this morning as only you can. And in Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. I want to take this time and thank you for watching and worshiping with us today. My name is Joey Dibman. I'm with Concord Missionary Baptist Church. If you are not a follower of Jesus Christ and have never asked Him to come into your heart, I'd like to take a few moments to help you do just that. You know, the Bible tells us in Romans 10:9 that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God has raised Him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. You know, this is open to every one of us that requests, because Romans 10:13 goes on to say even deeper, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So today, if you would like to pray with me, let's bow our heads in prayer to our Lord and Savior and ask Him if you're seeking Him to come into your heart today. Lord, I just want to take the opportunity that if there's someone out there today, and dear God, Lord, they're seeking you. Dear God, Lord, and maybe they're at a place in their life where they can't see. But today, through the Holy Spirit, which has pricked their heart, through your word, not the words that I preach, but through the holy word of an awesome Father, God, I pray today, dear God, Lord, that they would be enlightened. And God, I'd ask them today to pray with me and say, Lord, I want to be a believer. Dear God, Lord, I want to believe in the fact that I know that you walked on this earth. Lord, I want to know that you died for my sins. God, I want to believe in the fact that on the third day you resurrected from a tomb and you sit on the right hand of God. And today, Lord, I want to ask you to come into my heart. Lord, if there's one out there praying with us today, dear God, Lord, that's seeking you, Lord, I pray that they would say this prayer with me today, dear God, Lord, and invite Jesus Christ into their heart to forgive their sins. Lord, we thank you for your blessings upon us. God, we thank you for what you're doing for us. I just pray that you'd be with us through this moment in time. And dear God, Lord, and show us the things that you'd have us to see. In Christ's name we pray, Lord. Amen. You know, if you've done that today, if you've taken the opportunity to ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart, you know, he died on a cross close to 2,000 years ago and he walked on the earth. The Bible teaches us that everyone that calls upon the name of the Lord and believes in their heart that he has risen from the grave shall be saved. So if you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior today, now I want to invite you to, you know what, into your new relationship with your Father. And I want to maybe help you, maybe through watching the videos as you learn and you grow, but maybe try to find a church that's close to you. A church home where you can go with other believers and walk with them and learn to grow with them. I invite you today also that maybe if today you've asked Christ to come into your heart, that you know what, maybe you would let us know and drop us a postcard to say, you know, hey, I listen to these videos on YouTube. I appreciate what you've done, but I would like for y'all to know that on this date, on so-and-so, that I asked Jesus Christ to come into my heart. We'd invite you, and if you look at the address that's on the screen today and maybe send a postcard, and then, you know what, if you don't want to write it down, maybe through email. There will be an email address that you can address to our church at Concord Missionary Baptist Church. You could just email us and let us know what's going on in your life. But even better than that out there today, maybe you are a Christian today, and maybe you're not here in Temple, Georgia with us, but you're in your walk with Jesus today, and you're having some valleys that you're having to go through. And maybe you need to seek some prayer requests and some other shoulders to lean on. I invite you to also to email us or drop us a card. We meet on Wednesday nights to pray. We take these things before the Father. We take these things very seriously. We come together as a group as we pray to our Father. So I'd invite you to send those prayer requests to us. And I promise you that we'll take them and put them on the altar and bring them before the Lord. Once again, I want to thank so much for you taking your time to come spend with us and worship with us, you know, through song, through word, but more than anything else, through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. May God bless you and your family.